to another, right? And I'm going to try and control my emotions, all right? I've been to a child death investigator school, and I've seen photos and images of children that have been malnourished. And I'm telling you right now, this is the worst thing I've ever seen.
Oh, no, really?
Yes.
You don't know what I do every day. What do you do?
All right, relax your
hands. What the
relax your hands so she can fingerprint you.
Insinuate I'm a bad mother. You. That's my video. I have not once said that.
Se supone que los padres deben proteger y cuidar a sus hijos, pero lamentablemente no siempre es así. He aquí 8 de las ocasiones más impactantes en las que padres malvados se dieron cuenta de que habían sido arrestados. Empecemos por el despreciable caso de la superestrella olímpica Hope Solo. El 31 de marzo de 2022, los agentes de policía de Winston-Salem encontraron a Hope borracha y dormida con el coche en marcha. Para empeorar las cosas, supuestamente, Hope viajaba con sus dos hijos.
For kind of concerns, and you guys were out here sleeping and want to make sure you were okay. Okay, what's going on? Why are you sleeping out here in the parking lot?
I took a nap.
Okay, where do you live? 1324 code 2.
El oficial inmediatamente sospecha de Hope y le pregunta por qué duerme en su auto.
Kids okay? Okay, why are you sleeping in a parking lot?
Because I'm tired.
Okay, where do you live?
I live.
How much have you been drinking today? Why don't you turn the car off first? Let's turn the car off first.
It's okay if I...
It's okay, what? How much have you been drinking tonight?
I have not.
Are you sure?
I'm
asking you how much have you had to drink. I'm not asking you how much are you fine. I understand you're talking to me. How much have you had to drink today? Zero alcohol. All right, where's, do you have your ID with you?
Sorry, I'm just, I didn't have my ID.
Okay, can you get that for me, please?
Of course.
No, can you do that now, please? Thank you.
Hope continuó desplazándose en su teléfono, incluso haciendo una llamada telefónica, mientras el oficial esperaba que Hope le entregara su identificación.
So they were just concerned. And now when you roll up the window, I could smell alcohol. I could smell sweet odor of alcohol coming from you.
I don't think so, sir.
Yeah, and your eyes are telling me something different by looking at it, too. I'm trying to drink tonight. Just be sure with me. Zero alcohol.
Okay.
Can you get your ID, please? No, you're not. You're on your phone. I need you to get your ID for me, please.
I have every right to.
You do, and you have every right to comply with police when they're asking you for your ID.
Of course.
Can you please get that for me? Or where are you trying to come? Where are you coming from anyway?
I'm not.
Okay, where are you coming from?
My vehicle is not
even. Hope ahora arrastra las palabras aún más que antes y no puede seguir órdenes. Una clara señal de que está borracha, a pesar de que ella lo niega. Luego, se ve llegar a la escena a un segundo oficial y las cosas comienzan a intensificarse.
She's drunk. And she got two kids. She was passed out asleep in the front seat. She won't tell me anything. What she said, I was just sleeping. But you could smell, like, the odor, a sweet aroma, anyway, coming from inside that smells like alcohol. And she's completely oblivious to everything that's, like, going on right now.
Hope entrega su identificación, pero comienza a discutir con los oficiales.
Thank you, ma'am.
So, I just was gonna take a nap.
Okay. Where are you coming from?
It doesn't matter where I'm coming from, but the car has not been.
No, but it's been on.
No, it has not been on.
Yes, it was.
No, it wasn't, sir.
Ma'am, you turned the car off right in front of me.
I'm sorry, it was not.
The second officer takes over, while the initial officer leaves to run Solo's license, all while the soccer star continues looking through her phone.
I was just taking a nap.
I can do this. Step on out of the vehicle, or I will make you step out of the vehicle. I'm asking you nicely so you don't cause a scene in front of your kids. Yes, I can. I can do all these things. Okay? Step on out of the vehicle, Step on out of the vehicle for me. Step on out, or I'm pulling you out. Again, you have two kids in this car. You have two kids in this car. Don't embarrass you in front of your kids.
I'm not embarrassed.
Step out of the car.
Can you tell me why you're...
Step out of the car so I can make sure you are sober and able to be a competent adult in front of these kids.
I am a competent adult.
Okay, then step out of the car.
Can you tell me why...
Because you smell like alcohol.
That's fine.
And you're passed out
driving.
In the car with the car on. So step out of the vehicle. I'm not asking you again.
I would like to call my attorney.
Step out of the car.
The officer asks Solo to take field sobriety tests, but she refuses.
Los oficiales instan a Hope a que se someta a pruebas de sobriedad, pero ella se niega y comienza a requerir a su abogado.
You are not calling your attorney anyone right now. Right now, the two things you're going to do is you're going to stand here. Do you consent to providing field sobriety tests?
He took my phone.
Yes, I did.
Because you're not complying to law enforcement right now.
But I am complying.
No, you're not.
No, you're not.
I have two kids in the car.
Yes,
exactly.
And you've made them cry.
I took a knife.
You've made them cry now because you wouldn't comply.
I'm not driving.
You were, the car was on.
The car was not on, sir.
Okay. Then I'm taking you to jail.
Okay.
And you won't get your phone. Nope. 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 Sir. Put your hands behind your back. Now. You're now under arrest for resist, delay, obstruct of an officer.
Because we're trying to investigate something and you're not being cooperative right now.
Coming up.
I don't need you to touch me.
All right, let's go.
I can walk.
Una vez arrestada, los agentes obtienen una orden judicial para que les extraigan sangre y realizar una prueba de alcoholemia. En la estación de emergencias médicas, la actitud de Hope solo va cuesta abajo y sin frenos.
I don't need you to touch me. All
right, let's go.
I can walk by myself.
Well, make sure that
you don't need to touch me.
All right, that's fine.
All right, that's cool. Because I will have a complaint that you touched me inappropriately. Do not touch me.
I will
get in the car. You don't need to touch me. Ever. You're loving this, aren't you?
No,
You love it. You love every moment of it.
El análisis de sangre de Hope había dado positivo en alcohol y, sorprendentemente, en THC, un componente activo de la marihuana. Hasta ahora, los agentes no tenían ni idea de quién era ella realmente.
I had nothing else to do tonight, so I hope I was very entertaining for you, because I know I was. I know that I blessed you with my presence. Because that's what I do.
I hope your kids take care.
My kids are amazing.
I hope they're under good care with your husband.
They have the best mother and the best husband,
good.
The best father in the world.
Good.
Don't even insinuate that I'm not an amazing mother, you piece of shit. Jesus. You don't know what I do every day. What do you do?
All right. Relax your
hands.
Relax your hands so she can fingerprint you.
Insinuate I'm a bad mother. F you. That's my f you to you. I have not once said that, but if you insinuate that, I will say f you. I'm an amazing mother, and I'm there every day. Every day. Yeah. Go ahead and talk. You only want to put my children, because I have twins, by the way, children, in danger was your police officers crawling in my car without a search warrant. Oh, I saw that. Crawling in a car. No search warrant. And your police officers are crawling in my car letting my kids cry. Why? Because I pulled over to take a nap? That's cool. Way to get a mom. You got her. You got a mom. Good job.
Peace to you.
Good job, buddy. You're doing some good work in the world.
All right, you're good.
Cross back on.
Okay, let's get a mom.
And you won't get the phone. Nope.
As for the video,
que diga que es una madre increíble mientras la arrestan por conducir ebria y poner en peligro a sus hijos, muestra lo buena madre que es en realidad. Hope fue acusada de DWI, abuso infantil y resistencia al arresto. A cambio de un acuerdo de culpabilidad, se retiraron los cargos de abuso infantil y resistencia al arresto, tras lo cual la mujer ingresó en un programa de abuso de alcohol de 30 días. Sin embargo, el caso de Hope no es nada comparado con el que sigue, uno de los casos más despreciables y perturbadores que jamás hayas oído. Pero lo único que quiero saber es, ¿qué te impidió buscar ayuda? ¿Sabías que algo andaba mal? ¿Qué te detuvo? Cuéntanos la verdad. Seth y Tatiana Welch son una pareja de Solon Township, condado de Kent, Michigan, quienes tuvieron tres hijos, incluida Mary Ann, y el primero de ellos apagó el radar de los servicios de protección infantil durante un par de años después de que se encontrara una cantidad significativa de THC en su sistema. A pesar de eso, ninguno de los niños había ido nunca al médico, ya que Seth afirmó que ir al médico era tan peligroso como no ir. Su desconfianza en el mundo médico iba un paso más en las excesivas creencias religiosas de la pareja, que fueron utilizadas por ellos para justificar el abandono y el abuso infantil. Seth y Tatiana, a menudo, señalaban a sus hijos como babosas o sanguijuelas, necesitadas, perezosas, que les quitaban recursos y, por lo tanto, les negaban alimentos y otras necesidades básicas. A pesar de los innumerables informes de familiares y amigos, nunca se hizo nada para cambiar su comportamiento hacia sus hijos. Sus acciones, o más bien su inacción, llevaron desafortunadamente a la muerte de su hija Mary. Mary fue encontrada gravemente desnutrida, con los ojos hundidos, hematomas y llagas en el cuerpo. Los padres, para consternación de todos, llamaron primero a un abogado y una hora después a la policía. Cuando llegaron los agentes, encontraron a los niños cubiertos de tierra y heces.
Is that true that he doesn't, or he's very verbal?
He's very verbal.
I don't know. And you know how he gets mixed, you whisper one person's ear and as it goes down the chain, maybe he was just being shy. So
he tends to get shy. But
yeah, he did some high-fiving for me, but...
He knows lots of words, he's just sometimes Big Sister can be a little dominating. So
maybe that's what it is. And probably all the commotion probably really made him shy. So maybe they were just saying he was non-verbal right now, maybe that's what it was. Medical issues or anything like that? Okay.
Tatiana afirma que ninguno de sus hijos padecía condición médica alguna, a pesar de que ellos nunca habían ido al médico.
Or is she in any kind of daycare? Does she go to preschool?
No, I homeschool. I have my degree in early childhood education.
Okay.
So
good
I thought I'd just being at home at the farm, I can at least give them an initial education before
Okay, like what kind of stuff?
She is fluent in her alphabet, her numbers at least up to 20.
Yeah.
Although she knows other numbers like 160, she's practicing her writing.
Mm-hmm.
She just has a little issue with the numbers, they get a little backwards, but she knows how to spell words like hi, cat, dog. She knows the words that starts with E.
She can probably do better than Jason. The hi and the cat and dog part. So does a doctor that she sees, does she have a primary doctor?
Not anymore.
We did
have great and everything. We only go if there's an issue and there just hasn't been.
Obviously it was probably the last visit is when he recommended the helmet, head shaping. But so there was never any concern about the shape of her head from 0 to 18 months?
No, that's why it was such a concern for us as to why you would just bring this up out of nowhere. And
so what was the problem with the shape of her head according to him?
He said it was off. It was just not circular. And I mean, I wasn't offended. I was just taken aback. And then Seth found out that it's commission based with these products that they try and push. We don't know specifically, this is hearsay.
Sure.
But we think that trying to push the helmet. It was a $3,000 helmet for that and called CPS and said that we were being neglectful or something or other.
Tatiana afirma que ninguno de sus hijos padecía condición médica alguna, a pesar de que ellos nunca habían ido al médico. También sostiene que el problema médico que enfrentó uno de sus hijos fue solo una farsa inventada por un médico que intentaba ganar una comisión. Tatiana puede pensar que se está presentando a sí misma como una madre inteligente y compasiva, pero es todo lo contrario. Sus declaraciones solo sirven para mostrar cómo el abandono extremo es un patrón en su hogar.
Have you noticed a decline in poopy diapers?
No, not at all. She was such a surprise to me. I mean, this morning when I got her up, she had spit up, and I just
So yesterday morning, when you got her up at 7, she had spit up?
No, this morning.
Oh, this morning.
At 9, when I got her up, when I tried to get her up.
Yeah.
I thought maybe she choked on her spit.
What color was her spit up?
It was foamy and brown. So I thought maybe it was the oatmeal and the fruit mixed in there.
So where was her spit up at?
The side of her mouth. The side of her face.
And was that, did you think, I don't know, was that food? Was it blood?
No, it wasn't.
It was not blood. Did she have any kind of vomiting of blood or anything like that?
No, never.
Okay.
We would take it to her doctor.
Well, sure.
That never happened.
So you were certain it was food?
Yes, essentially.
And it was on the side, it was on what side of her face?
Her right side.
Her right side, okay. And then that's when you noticed that she was unresponsive. It was this morning when you saw that. And what happened next?
Her eyes are open.
Did anything else look strange other than obviously the spit up and that her eyes were open? Or other than that, did she look as usual?
She's just cold.
Okay.
So I went in to get set. And it's an emergency. And he's like, and I was just so shocked. And he reminded me I knew CPR and he told me to start. So I took her from the bed and I put her on her changing table. And I started CPR and I did the two finger touch on the chest. If you use your whole hand, you could break ribs. And I didn't want to do that, that's for sure.
I know this is tough.
So I did a two-finger touch on her chest and her back, and I wiped her mouth, and I did...
So you did this on the kitchen table?
No, the changing table.
The changing table in the bedroom?
Yes.
So you said you did it on her mouth, and then you wiped her mouth?
I wiped her mouth first because it was the spit-up. And now that I think about it, I think it was banana and oatmeal. You know when banana's been sitting out and it's very ripe?
Oh, yeah.
It gets that, like, brownish color?
Yeah.
But ripe banana is very sweet, and that she eats the oatmeal better with it.
So what did you wipe her mouth with?
A baby wipe. A lavender-scented baby wipe.
Okay. And then you did what with that?
I threw it in the garbage.
Okay.
Well, not immediately, no. I just wiped her and put it to the side.
Just wiped her and threw it down? Yeah.
Right next on the changing table.
And then you picked her up out of the bed?
Yes. And then I put her on the changing table, and then when I was pumping her chest, there was, like, bubbles coming out of her mouth.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought maybe that's why I thought she choked. And then maybe if I kept pumping, like, it would, like, maybe it would come out, and then she'd, like, cough and wake up. Because I just kept wiping the bubbles, and I was giving her air and giving her, pumping with my fingers, just my two fingers.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe I should have done more.
Nope, you're doing it right.
And she was still so cold, and... I think maybe 10 minutes, I don't... It's so hard to gauge time.
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
And, it's not just me the whole time, and he's just asking me, is she dead? Is she gone? While he's crying, just asking me, is she gone? And it's just so hard to say yes, and she said yes. She's just unresponsive. And then we had no idea what to do then at all. Like, what do we do?
Mm-hmm.
And so he called his parents, or he called his dad first, excuse me, and his dad said, okay, your mom and I are on our way. Call the police. Let them know what happened, and we'll try and get there before they do. And then we just spent the entire time on the couch.
A lo largo del interrogatorio, Tatiana inserta mentiras falsas para parecer una madre ideal. Mentiras que el detective capta rápidamente, incluyendo cómo Tatiana le dejaba leche a su hija mientras iba a trabajar y con qué frecuencia la alimentaba. No solo eso, Tatiana también miente acerca de llamar inmediatamente a la policía, ya que los investigadores saben con certeza que llamaron 3 horas después de que se encontrara el cuerpo de Mary, después de que los Welch, sorprendentemente, consultaran primero a su abogado.
Parents in this room. Okay. we all need to be honest. Remember in the car when I first talked with you and I told you that at the end of the day, we all need to know exactly. Right? Okay. So we need to tell her story. Okay? And I want you to think about this for a minute. I want you to think for a second and put yourself in our shoes. You're the police officer. You're the police detective. You get called out to that home today. You get called to my home or his home today. Okay, you the police officer. And then you have to go into that house and you have to look at that precious little angel. Okay? Do you think she was healthy, honestly?
When you look at her signs and you can see every single bone in her body, do you think she was healthy?
We know this isn't easy, Tatiana, but we need to know what happened to her. What was going on?
So when did she start losing all that weight? But she's lost so much weight that you can't lose that much in 2 days. I've never seen a child that skinny. Never. And here's the thing. You're obviously a very concerned mom, but at what point did you think something was wrong?
El detective está tratando de aprovechar el lado emocional de Tatiana diciéndole que es una madre preocupada, lo que a su vez la haría sentir más cómoda y abierta a la policía.
Last time that you actually inspected her, that you looked at her, tell me the truth.
Every time when I change her, and I think I just may have been just so blinded.
What were you blinded by? Because I know, listen, you are an intelligent, articulate, college educated, early childhood development. You know when you look at someone that something's wrong. I have a picture of her right here. I'm prepared to show you. That tells you. No medical treatment, as dumb as I am. I'm not near as intelligent as you. I can't speak the words you can speak. I am not you. And even I can look at this photo and I can say, whoa, something's wrong. It put tears in our eyes when we walked in there. It was that obvious.
Tatiana, I'm going to be quite honest with you right now, okay? One parent to another. Right, and I'm going to try and control my emotions, all right? I've been to a child death investigator school, and I've seen photos and images of children that have been malnourished. And I'm telling you right now, this is the worst thing I've ever seen.
Oh, no, really?
Yes.
Oh.
Okay. You know what? This is baggage. This is something that... But all I want to know is what stopped you from seeking help? You knew something was wrong. What stopped you? Tell us the truth.
I mean, are you guys that financially strapped? I mean, what is it? Do you not believe in health care? Do you have religious beliefs? I mean, what is it?
We do have religious beliefs, and we were praying about it, and we have faith that...
When did you start praying about it?
Después de que el oficial menciona el tema, Tatiana introduce la religión como excusa de por qué se negarían a ir al médico.
I think within a month it started to become. I was a bit up and down. Her cheeks would be full and bright, and then a couple of days later she would look ill or hungry, and then we're not hungry, just her cheeks wouldn't be as full as they were.
Shrunken then.
Yeah, and then.
So when did you notice that she had other bones showing?
About a month.
Well, let me ask you this: when was the last time you bathed her?
Maybe 2 weeks ago.
So about a month ago, you notice that her bones are all showing, right? And so, is that when you started happily praying?
No, it was the past few days, because about a month ago it'd be like full, and then 2 days later it'd be shrunken in, but then within the day it'd be full again. But then the past few days it wouldn't. fill up as quickly as it did.
But listen, here's what I'm saying, Mary. Listen, I get that, but her legs were as small as my pointer finger. So that didn't happen in 3 days.
No.
And I know that you know that, and I know that you wanted to get her help, but I'm trying to just figure out, when did this happen? I understand that maybe you started seeing some kind of symptoms a month ago, but when did she consistently lose all of this weight? When did she consistently become skin and bones?
I think it was within the month. She was always just so thin. And
so within a month, so then why, when we had a month to look at her like this, why didn't we get help?
We thought she'd get better without getting help.
How did you think she was going to get better?
By feeding her and being with her.
Was she really truly eating the way that you were telling us?
Yes, because
if you want, he has a photo of her, and if you want to see it, I mean, I'm pretty sure that I explained this to both you and Seth when you were in my car with me. There's going to be an autopsy done, okay? And there was a person from the medical examiner's office at the house, okay?
So we're gonna know all this, we're saying,
yeah.
But and you're not a bad person. We get all this, and we get that there's a dynamic here that we're trying to figure out. There is a dynamic here. I'm gonna tell you, I know it. I know there's a dynamic, and I feel that you wanted to get her help. I'm trying to just figure out why you didn't. What's the dynamic? What am I missing? Because you can't tell me that this Brooklyn, New York, this New York college, city college educated, Grand Rapids Community College, early childhood person didn't know that this girl needed help, but something stopped.
El detective no cree que el marido de Tatiana, Seth, realmente haya tenido algo que ver en impedir que ella alimentara a su hija. Luego, la empuja a cambiar su historia falsa, acercándose cada vez más a la verdad detrás de lo que realmente sucedió.
Seth told you that God told him to sacrifice one of your children. Would you do it?
No.
That's what I'm saying, though. That's what I'm trying to wrap my head around. How many conversations did you have with Seth about this?
Not very many. Maybe two at most, just because we didn't want to worry about it. We trusted God then.
Would he get angry talking about it?
No, I think he'd be very sure.
What would happen? How would he react if you took her to the doctor anyway?
Not sure if it, something like that has never happened.
I'm just asking to speculate.
I think he would just be concerned that GPS would be called, but not angry, just say, okay, just know that you took the doctor, expect GPS to come to the house.
He's not an angry type person?
No.
How is he as far as emotional goes?
He's not afraid to cry.
Does he cry a lot? Would you say that he wears his emotions on his sleeve?
I suppose. When we were going through our marriage, the beginning of it, and he was very expressive about how about his feelings and how he would like to be treated and how I was treating him well, and then in return told me he realized that he wasn't being a respectful husband and wasn't treating me well either. So he's very intuitive and expressive, which is rare, I suppose.
El detective se enfrenta a Tatiana en cuanto a por qué la policía no fue llamada tan pronto como encontraron a Mary muerta.
Sorry, I don't have the answer for you. I was just so... Never could imagine that could happen.
Jason and I have been doing this a long time, and I understand, and I've seen it time and time again. Everybody deals with stress and reacts to things differently. But if there's one thing that I've seen in the course of doing this job for a long time is... there's usually never a hesitation to pick up the phone and call 911. That is a pretty ingrained, rapid, basic, life-saving response that is ingrained in everybody, especially in our country, because of our emergency medical system that we have.
When did you first teach your kids about 911?
When did I try it?
When did you first teach your children about 911?
Less than a year ago.
Okay. So when you're doing CPR, you don't scream to Seth, call 911.
No. And I know that that's like the second step, or the first step, actually. What?
Did you think by calling 911 that he would think your faith was less?
No, not at all, actually. He called his dad first. Wiping the spit up from her face, and then he went to contact his parents. I don't know how long that took. I was just, after she wasn't responding, I was just sitting there rocking her. I don't know for how long. I have no idea for how long. And then after he got off the phone with his dad said, okay, wait until we are close. So, and then call the police so we can get there at the same time they do, so we can help with anything, I suppose, legally.
So, the 2+ hours of time that went by from discovery till 911, all I know, and I'm just asking if you can think of anything else, all I know of is 10 minutes of CPR and sitting on a couch and sweeping the house. Is there any other activity that occurred? Again, some of the stuff is just so weird, we're just trying to make sense of it.
I understand. If I were in your position, I wouldn't understand it either, and I'm having trouble gauging it as well. I spent quite some time just holding her, and just rocking her, and then I put her back down on her bed, and I put her blanket on her, and then I just checked on the kids, make sure they were cleaning their room, and then...
Did you put any additional clothing on her when you put her back in the crib?
No, I didn't.
So what was in the crib is exactly what was in there. You didn't change anything.
Oh, I'm sorry. By clothing, I just assumed you meant what she was wearing on her. That was left on her. I added her. I covered her up fully, and I added her little head blanket.
What do you mean you covered her fully? With clothing or a blanket?
Oh, with a gray blanket.
Okay.
Was that blanket in the crib prior or not?
Yes, up to her knees. I wrap it around her knees, down to her feet, just so there's no more chance of over the head pulling. She's never done that before.
And what about this thing that you were talking about, the head pillow or whatever? Where was that
at? It was just a comfy blanket. It was on the side on the rocking chair. I just watched.
So that's the only thing that wasn't in the crib? Was that one?
Yeah. And she had her polar bear in there, but it was by her feet.
Después de terminar con Tatiana, los detectives se trasladan a la habitación donde se encuentra Seth. Seth parece frío y distante, y esto puede deberse a que lo dejaron esperando todo el tiempo que los detectives hablaron con su esposa, después de que le leyeran sus derechos. Los investigadores le preguntan a Seth sobre la época y los incidentes que ocurrieron cuando nació su primer hijo.
I'm very anti-medical industry is because of what happened with her birth. She coughed one time, so they said that they had to keep her under observation for 72 hours to make sure she didn't have a breathing problem. She didn't have a breathing problem. She coughed one time to clear some birth fluid out of her lungs.
Right.
And they kept us under observation for 72 hours.
Wow, you're paying for it?
Of course. Yeah, the bill was about $15,000. So that was kind of... That was kind of a kick in the rear, and then afterwards we had some problems where I actually had a doctor make a fraudulent CPS claim, and I actually forged paperwork and stuff like that, and I tried to make a complaint about it, but nobody listens.
More of a get-rich scheme, wasn't it? Kind of
yeah.
Like, I'm gonna make some money off from a product someone really doesn't need.
Yes. He issued two separate platers, forms of paperwork. One that had a bunch of notes on it saying all sorts of bad healthcare things we were doing wrong with the CS person. And the copy of the paperwork he gave to us that said she was fine. So, so that was about my last straw with it.
Was that to do with the helmet? And is that all, so it all started with, if I'm right, it all started with the helmet.
Yeah, pretty much. I mean,
no, I started with the cough, but
yeah.
To the helmet.
I'm not a big fan of a lot of the immunization stuff, and so I kind of balked against that, and they didn't like that either. You know, they even got to the point where they, the first time we changed doctors, they called CPS on us just for changing doctors. Because the doctor we were seeing was all the way in Byron Center.
Seth se presenta a sí mismo como una víctima de las crueles técnicas de los médicos para ganar dinero extra. En Tatiana, todo lo que Seth hace es confirmar los patrones de abandono infantil a los que él y su esposa se ajustan. Luego, Seth habla de cómo preparó alimentos nutritivos para sus hijos mientras su esposa estaba en el trabajo. Pero cuando se le pregunta por qué María parecía desnutrida, Seth tiene una respuesta absurda, afirmando que Dios crea personas de diversas formas y tamaños.
So I kind of chalked it up to that. I was not happy about how skinny she was. That's why if you look in the house, you can see all the baby food. That's potatoes with chicken and cheese and all, everything matches up with what I'm saying. She was always very healthy. She was never sick. Okay, that's it. She's sickly and skinny, but she was always just skinny.
But that's where I'm going to disagree with you. Okay? I'm a parent. I'm a father. I have three children.
Mm-hmm.
He's a father. You're a father.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And I'm just being honest with you. Okay? Because I don't know how to be anything other than. Okay? And I'm telling you right now, I've been doing this job for a long time. Okay? And he'll tell you when I walked in that bedroom today. All right? I started crying. Okay? I looked at that little baby. And I looked at her for a millisecond,
mm-hmm.
and I knew that she wasn't right. And I knew that she wasn't right for some time, okay? And you're her father.
Yes. And I'll tell you, I saw her when she was dead, too. She was much more gaunt when she was dead than she ever was when she was alive. I mean, I got pictures on my phone.
Right, but let me ask you this. When's the last time you saw that baby? Without any clothes on, in a bath.
Me, I've never given her a bath.
Okay, but you changed her diaper maybe a day and a half ago, correct?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I'm not putting words in your mouth. You said that, correct?
Mm-hmm.
How did you not, when you looked at her a day and a half ago, changing her diaper, and realize that my daughter is skin and bone? When I looked at her belly in the house. Okay? And I'm not exaggerating this.
I know.
I could see the outline of her intestines through her stomach. I could see her spine completely through her back. I could see every one of her ribs through her chest.
Yeah, I'm not happy about it either. You know, you're welcome to go through my garbage and look at the baby food containers. And
here's the thing. I'm certainly not knocking on his faith. I have the same faith and same creator that you have. Does your faith prevent you from allowing you to use medical services?
Verlo responder de la forma en que lo hace con ese comportamiento, como si no estuviéramos hablando de nada aquí, es absolutamente enfurecedor. Y a veces, los detectives también miran de esa manera, controlando sus impulsos contra este hombre. Luego, los investigadores le preguntan a Seth si se siente responsable de lo que le pasó a Mary, y su respuesta es bastante intrigante.
Responsible in some way for what has come about, and so do I. I take responsibility on myself for anything that goes wrong in my life at all, even if it's totally not my fault. I still
What could I have done?
En el fondo, todos sabemos que Seth no se siente realmente responsable de la muerte de su hija, como afirma. Luego, se permite que él y Tatiana se reúnan, pero su conversación, que debería haber sido sobre su hija muerta, se centra en el estresante interrogatorio por el que acababan de pasar.
Then what'd you do while you were waiting? I called off work. I slept and I sat and cried.
Then listen to this, baby. You know, their job is to fill cells. It's their job. So they can fill two cells right now. And that's.
Maybe you were angry. Like it sounded like they were trying. Like a movie night, but like separate us.
Of course, that's what they're doing. Well, trying to drive a wedge in between and then hope somebody accuses the other one. That's why they came at you first. Because they own them.
They can tell by looking at me.
Yeah. They're gonna do shit to me. So if I'm going to break down on the cue, me is who they're looking for.
What are we going to do?
You go home and we get really baked. I mean, I really like to not talk about it at all anymore today.
Okay.
So damn. Can't ever do this again. We at least gotta take her. We gotta, there's problems. We gotta take them to the doctor at least to see.
Okay.
I think they must have heard me on the phone. Because that's to my mom at 7:30. I'm getting up out of here. Getting us out of here. And that's exactly when they came through the door to come talk to us.
Wow.
You know, I was like, I'll wait till 7:30, but we're not under arrest. Not being charged. I'm here under my own compulsion. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm free to go, so.
Your parents are still dead?
No, they went home. They had to go meet with a CPS worker in Grand Haven.
Oh, wow. But they could still with them?
Yeah. No, I was just about to walk out of there. When he said, hey, come on down here. So I was going to be like, oh, he said 5 minutes. It's going to be another 2 hours. You know, he had me put my phone out beside the door.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, I went out. I don't let you just hold me in here indefinitely with my permission while leaving me communication.
I saw the papers in the bottle cap and the lighter was out there. Because they told me to run a mess when I was going to the bathroom. And it was like 20, 30 minutes. And I really had to go. So I just opened the door and I went to the bathroom.
They're trying to make you seem a lot more like a prisoner than you really are. Right now, you're here under your own compulsion and I'm not your own.
Yeah.
It's really not much they can do if we wanted to walk out right now. We're doing this as a show. But not even for them. But for probably when we have to go up in front of a judge.
Riéndose de las preguntas que les hicieron, Seth y Tatiana muestran signos claros de narcisismo, ya que no podían preocuparse por María. Seth y Tatiana fueron claramente acusados del asesinato de su hija Mary Welch. A pesar de las horas en un largo interrogatorio, durante la sentencia, la boca de Seth se abre de par en par en un shock increíble, y su esposa Tatiana se rompe después de que se les dijera que son encontrados culpables.
That is a charge called homicide felony murder. It is life without parole. It requires a DNA sample to be taken upon arrest, which is often like a cotton swab or in the inside of your cheek. The second offense that you're both charged with is called child abuse in the first degree, where they're alleging you knowingly or intentionally caused serious physical harm to a child. They're talking about this Mary Welch. It is a felony, possible penalty of up to life imprisonment, or any term of years less than life.
Seth y Tatiana Welch fueron sentenciados a cadena perpetua sin libertad condicional por el asesinato en primer grado de su hija. A pesar de todo, la postura de Seth sobre los médicos y su inacción, que causaron la muerte de Mary, todavía no parece haber cambiado.
We were chosen to go through this trial because God has prepared me to be a strong voice for him. Whether I am to be vindicated and set free, and the courts can see that this was truly just, I don't think it's unexplainable, sir. I think that the autopsy was lazily done. I believe that they found the cause of death, and that was, they stopped there. But as we know, something caused her body to shut down that way. And I will say also that I had a farm animal, a goat, just a couple days before, who died of the exact same way. He had food, he had water. I even watched him eat, and he still just wasted away before my eyes.
So even given what you know now, you don't wish that you had been taking her for regular treatment from a pediatrician?
Well, here's the thing, sir. I just don't... like I said, it seems to me, from what I see, not only from what I see with my own two eyes going on among the people of this nation, but also the statistics that are out there that you can find that aren't readily published on the news or talked about in mainstream education, but you can find them if you look. I mean, it's dangerous to take your kid to the doctor's office these days. It is. It just plain is. And you know, if you don't do what they say, if you don't buy what they want you to buy so that they can make some money off you, for the love of money is the root of all kinds of evils, they'll call the government on you. I had it happen, sir.
Y como era de esperar, las personas malvadas que hacen lo contrario que deberían hacer los padres no se detienen aquí. ¿Qué dije? Está bajo arresto por agresión a un menor y posesión de, oh, mi señor. El 22 de agosto de 2023, el Departamento de Policía de Stillwater recibió una irrupción de padres muy angustiados en la estación y le dijeron a los oficiales que habían encontrado videos e imágenes inquietantes de su hija de 3 años. Tras el informe, los agentes llegaron a la casa de Ashley Cheatham, de 19, y la pusieron inmediatamente bajo arresto.
Hello.
Yeah.
Okay. You Ashley? What's your last name? Okay. We're gonna pay for you.
Where is he?
El novio de Ashley le había dicho a la policía que la había conocido en línea y que acababan de mudarse con su hija de 3 años. Ashley abrió la puerta sin pantalones y los oficiales rebuscaron por la casa para encontrarle un par de jeans para ponerse.
Yeah, there's some right there. There's pajama pants are fine.
check the chain in there?
You got any form of like slip on shoe or anything?
Put him up in his front a little bit. They're like falling down.
Is your ID in your purse? You got that to be with it?
Luego, mientras le explican por qué la arrestan, Ashley se derrumba, pero no se deje engañar para que sienta empatía por esta mujer, ya que simplemente está llorando por haber sido atrapada.
You're under arrest for sexual battery. Of a minor.
And
possession of child.
Ashley ahora enfrenta múltiples cargos que incluyen a un menor de edad menor de 12 años, hacer y distribuir material obsceno de menores, posesión de marihuana por nombrar algunos. Se le ordenó no tener contacto con la víctima. Antes del arresto, Ashley supuestamente había estado entrevistando para el puesto de maestra de escuela primaria. Las rápidas acciones del padre no solo ayudaron a su hija, sino que también salvaron a muchas otras personas de correr un destino similar en esa escuela primaria. No hay forma de volver a confiar en alguien si hace lo que esta mujer le hizo al hijo de este hombre. Ahora imagina que es tu propia madre la que te hace algo terrible. Bueno, eso es exactamente lo que pasó en nuestro siguiente caso. El 19 de mayo de 2018, la policía de Delray Beach recibió múltiples llamadas al 911 sobre una mujer que supuestamente estaba en un techo con dos niños pequeños. Los oficiales llegan al lugar e intentan calmar a la mujer, sintiendo que podría desarrollarse una tragedia.
Darling, it's okay. Dear. All right. Everybody back up. Dear. Listen to me. You're not in trouble for anything.
I'm done. Okay.
Just get the kids back inside, please. Please, that's all we want you to do. Just get the kids back inside.
How do we get in the house?
They're real. We're gonna help.
Let's get breaching tools.
Luego, un oficial logra alcanzar a la mujer y a los niños y rescatarlos trepando por la ventana. Lo que sucede después es absolutamente increíble.
It's okay. Please, we're here to help, okay? We're here to help.
Oh, wait, no, you're not a real one.
No, I want to see your badge.
Oh, right here.
There you go. Yeah, right here.
Come on.
See?
One of you guys go inside, open this window up. I'll hand you the kids.
No. I want to see your badge.
Okay, here.
I want to see your badge.
Let me show you.
It's okay.
Look.
I want to see your badge.
There you go.
Really?
Yeah, real.
No, really. Let me see.
Yeah, right here. Look. See? It says police.
Sergeant?
Yeah.
No, it doesn't say sergeant.
I'll hand you the kids.
No, who are you?
Okay, guys, we're gonna walk with Mike here, okay? Here, come walk with Mike.
No!
Guys, we're okay.
No! Okay, come on!
It's okay.
Mom,
big step, okay?
No!
Guys, we're walking this way. You guys wanna see what we're walking to? We're gonna walk to that police officer, okay?
Take the little one. Come here, baby, go. You're okay.
Here, we're gonna go with this fun police officer.
You're okay.
Come here, buddy. You all right, buddy?
La mujer fue detenida e internada en un centro de salud mental. Ella enfrentó cargos penales. Mientras tanto, el DCF tomó la custodia de los niños. Actualmente no tengo más información sobre el caso. Solo puedo esperar que estos niños estén bien y vivan una buena vida. Pero si pensabas que las cosas no podían empeorar, es porque no conoces el increíble caso de la familia Brooks. Entonces, ¿por qué no solucionamos esto ahora en lugar de sentarnos aquí, porque no nos iremos? El 25 de febrero de 2019, la policía de Chandler recibió informes sobre negligencia infantil con respecto a la familia Brooks, que operó en contra de las órdenes del médico y llevó a su hijo enfermo directamente a casa en lugar de a la sala de emergencias. Luego, la policía de Chandler visitaba a los Brooks, pero los dejaban esperando en la puerta sin respuesta de la familia. Luego, los oficiales llamaron al Dr. Bain para obtener información detallada del médico.
Question in regards to a patient you spoke or you saw earlier today. His name is Bryce.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
He's a 2-year-old kid. Do you recall who that person is?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I just wanted to, I'm trying to get in contact with the parents to try to see why the child hasn't gone to a hospital yet.
Right.
I just wanted to ask about what kind of medical problem he had today when he saw you.
Sure.
Can you just give me a rundown of what it was?
Una hora más tarde, los agentes hacen un segundo intento de contactar a la familia, pero fue en vano.
Chandler PD. Sarah Brooks. We just need to talk.
Luego, llaman a Brooks y responde.
Hi, is this Brooks?
This is.
Hi, Brooks. This is Officer Cassio with Chandler PD. How you doing tonight?
Doing fine. Stop banging on my door. Let my kids sleep.
Okay. So, here's our problem. Basically, the reason why we're knocking on your door is because we need to check on your son, who...
Okay, he's doing fine. His fever's broke. He's under 100 degrees. He's doing just fine.
Okay, well, we need to see it for ourselves, and...
No, you don't need to.
We need to talk to you outside. So why don't you come outside so we can talk about this?
No, thank you.
El padre se niega a hablar con la policía y les pide que no molesten a sus hijos dormidos. Preocupados por la salud y el bienestar del niño y no queriendo darse por vencido, los oficiales hacen otro intento para intentar acceder al niño.
Brooks. I saw the hand. Like I said, here are your options. You either come out here and talk to us so we can figure out how we're going to get your kid to the hospital, or DCS is going to take temporary custody of your kids. I'm giving you the opportunity to come out here and just talk to me. So why don't we figure this out now instead of sit here? Because we're not leaving.
Hello?
Brooks?
Yes, sir.
Do I need to repeat myself what I said outside the window?
I can hear you through the window. I talked to you on the phone. That's
okay.
What I did.
All right. Here's your first option. You come out and talk to us.
Do you have a warrant to take my kids?
We have DCS here that's going to take temporary custody of your kids if you don't come out and talk to us. You're making this way more worse than it needs to be.
No, my kids are fine.
Brooks,
you guys are making it way worse than this.
Okay, Brooks, if they're fine, then why don't you make this simple and come out and talk to us?
They're not going to force me to go to the hospital, spend treatment and emergency room visit right now.
Well, here's the thing. All the doctors told you what was going on with your son, and they said that they strongly told you to go to the hospital and get him checked out because
his fever didn't break. His fever broke. Gave him a bath and his fever broke. He's doing fine.
Look, Brooks, I talked to the doctors already, and they said that this could be a possible life-threatening situation.
It's not a life-threatening
situation. Listen, I know you're saying that the fever broke now, and he's feeling better. But
if he gets worse, then we'll go to the hospital.
Well, no. Well, Brooks, we need you to come outside and talk to us.
No.
If, like I said, if you don't come out and talk to us, and we have to deal with this, make this even worse than it needs to be, then those kids will be taken away, and you guys are going to be in some serious trouble. Because as of right now, you were told by the doctors that he needs to go to an emergency room. That was told to you guys, and we have all the information from all the doctors saying. Now, you knowing that makes it even worse for you guys because it could be a felony charge. But I would rather just have you come out and just let us deal with this and let's go take the kid to the hospital.
So if I take my kid to the hospital right now, you guys will leave and my wife can stay with my kids?
Yeah, if you come out and talk to us, both of you, we can go from there and...
What are my other two kids going to do? Both of our parents can't leave the hospital.
Well, no, I'm not saying you both leave the hospital, but let's get your son, who's sick, to the hospital tonight.
All three of my kids are sick, dude.
Well, the one you took to the doctor is the one we're concerned about because he apparently is more sick than the others.
I don't care about my other two kids, though.
You can bring your kids with you if you think they need it.
No, they don't. None of my kids need to go to the hospital. They're fine. None of them have fevers right now. They have the cough and the sniffles. They're not in life danger.
Yeah, that's not going to fly.
Es desgarrador escuchar al padre restar importancia a la enfermedad de su hijo y no prestar atención a las advertencias tanto de los médicos como de la policía. A pesar de sus múltiples intentos de acceder al niño o a los padres para evaluar más a fondo la situación, a los agentes no les quedó otra opción que forzar la entrada.
Thanks. Hold there. Make more announcements.
Chandler Police Department, come out with your hands up. Chandler Police Department, we're not going to leave until you come out with the child. Chandler Police Department, we will come in if you do not come out! This is the Chandler Police Department. We're here to check on the safety of your child. You need to come to the front door. Chandler Police Department! We have a court order from CPS to take temporary custody of your child. You need to come to the front door. We're here to provide medical attention for your child.
Brooks?
Yeah.
Power your hands up.
Hands up. Let me see both your hands. Turn around. Face away from us. Come out slowly.
How many people consist of who?
Three kids and my wife.
Where's your wife at?
I'm not sure actually right now. I thought she was coming to the front door. Thank you guys.
What's her name?
Sarah.
Any others inside we can know about?
Yeah.
What do you got?
I've got a bunch of guns, man. They're all locked up.
Does Sarah have access to the safe?
No.
Where's the child right now?
They're in my bed.
The sick child.
I'm actually on the, I'm not sure. I was sleeping with my two daughters in my master bedroom.
Sarah, come out to the front door. The Chandler Police Department. Come out to the front door. Keep your hands up so we can see them.
Okay, come to us. Come out slowly. Come out to us. Come on.
Okay. Is that the child in question?
Yes.
Okay. One last thing, please.
Ambos padres fueron acusados de un cargo cada uno de abuso infantil. El niño en cuestión Bryce Brooks, afortunadamente recibió la asistencia médica necesaria y sobrevivió. Pero esconderse con un niño enfermo y no brindarle atención médica no es lo único que hacen los padres malvados. ¿Qué estás haciendo? Ella estaba dormida, así que entré corriendo. No puedes dejar a tu hijo, un bebé, afuera en el auto. 1. Hace 55 grados con el sol sobre ellos. 2. Ese auto está abierto. Cualquiera podría haber venido, haberse llevado a ese niño y haberse ido. ¿Ves lo tonto que fue eso? El 18 de mayo de 2022, los agentes de policía de Ohio recibieron una llamada de un transeúnte preocupado para quejarse de que un bebé estaba solo en un automóvil. Una mujer llamada Kayla Jenkins supuestamente dejó a su bebé solo en su auto durante un día caluroso.
I just want to tell you what I just witnessed, and I don't know if it's just me being overprotective or if I'm just crazy.
Okay, what's going on?
This lady left an infant child alone in a vehicle, and when I say infant, this baby's months old, alone inside a running vehicle, and she went inside the Dollar Tree.
Tras la llamada, los agentes llegaron al lugar para investigar más a fondo la situación, solo para hacer un descubrimiento impactante.
Just go over the door open so we don't overheat.
Para empeorar las cosas, al parecer, el bebé se quedó solo en el coche que estaba abierto. El testigo que hizo la llamada luego da su declaración mientras otro oficial registra la tienda en busca de la mamá.
Hey, buddy.
37.
I was originally parked right here.
Yeah.
But I wanted to get out. And I'm like, what the hell?
Yeah.
And then I thought it was a joke. And she wasn't young either, man.
I don't know. It's better to keep this. Where'd she go?
Dollar Tree. He's going to save a lot.
25, she went to the Dollar Tree. I wonder if I should keep this closed for the baby.
I opened it.
Okay.
Because he went around and opened that door, so I opened it up to make sure the baby was breathing and everything.
Yeah, we got the keys.
But it was running and stuff. They had the car running. Dispatcher, I said, he only looked. I said, I seen him through the window. I said, he looks like a few months.
You want some?
I said, he only looks like a few months young to me, man.
You think it's all right for a drink?
Look at that. That's crazy, dude. She's not young. She looks like she knows better than this.
Like a 64-year-old lady.
Car. I don't. Yeah. Oh, trust me, I know.
Oh my God.
Be a fun day to be a cop today.
She in there? It comes back to like a 64-year-old. What did she look like?
I'll identify her, man.
All right.
I seen her. We'll wait for her to come out.
I've
seen her walk out. I'm sure she's in there. I couldn't.
What did she look like?
It wasn't the. She didn't look 64 to me, bro.
What did she look like?
She didn't look 64.
Al no poder localizarla, los oficiales esperan a que la madre termine sus compras. No es hasta varios minutos más tarde que la madre decide volver por su hijo solo para ser reprendida por el oficial.
You left your baby in an unlocked car out here while you go into Dollar Tree. What are you doing?
She was asleep, so I just ran in.
You can't leave your child out, an infant in the car. One, it's 55 degrees out with the sun on him. All right. Two, that car is unlocked. Anybody could have came and taken that kid and left. All right. You see how dumb that was?
Yeah.
Right. Do you have a license on you?
Yeah.
Over to your baby. Make sure she's all right. Other side.
Thank you.
El hecho de que el oficial tuviera que decirle que fuera a ver a su bebé lo dice todo. Después de comprobar su licencia, el oficial interroga más a la madre. Es entonces cuando Kyla se da cuenta del problema en el que se encuentra.
Child's father in the picture. Is this your mother's vehicle?
Yeah.
What's her contact information? Dad's not in the picture. I'm gonna get grandma's info.
You just give me the
names. Okay. Alright. Your mother's the registered owner of this vehicle?
Yeah.
What's her phone number?
What is going on?
You're gonna be needing some paperwork here in a second. So what is your mother's contact information?
Do
you know what's going on? You're gonna be getting a ticket for endangering children. So what is your mother's contact information? Case Medina, County Job and Family Services.
I thought you just contacted me. I live with her.
What is her contact information? Phone number for her. Do you think it's smart to leave a 14-year-old in a car? Unlocked and running? Regardless if you're in Brunswick or not? What is your mother's phone number?
Why can't they just call me?
What is your mother's
phone? Why can't they just call me?
They probably will call you. Did you give that officer your phone number? What's your phone number? Are you employed? You're currently unemployed.
Kyla está claramente incrédula y conmocionada, pero el oficial sabe que no debe empeorar las cosas para ella. Como en lugar de reprenderla, le advierte de manera objetiva y solidaria.
Understand why this is such a big deal?
Yeah.
Okay. I understand it was an error in judgment and it was just a dumb decision, but that very often leads to the kid dying in the stroke in the back of the car. We're getting kidnapped, right? So really this is a better outcome than us finding a kid dead in the back of the car. All right?
Understand?
Okay.
Do you have any questions for me?
I don't.
Oh.
What the hell?
Yeah. If you have any questions, call the Brunswick Police Department. Don't leave your kid in the car again, you understand? So what's going to happen is you're going to go to court, you're going to enter your plea, the mayor will give you a sentence, right? Likely for your first offense, it's going to be some type of fine. You can work out a payment plan, whatever you got to do. No, we just do one more unit. Just make sure you don't do this again. I don't want to find your kid dead somewhere, seriously. Right? That's why it's such a big issue. Right.
I do take this really seriously.
Listen, and I get it, it was an error of judgment. It's a learning experience, but so many times parents will walk away.
I just thought she would be okay because the car was running and I was right there.
I understand, but you understand somebody can just grab this kid and go. You're lucky it was an off-duty police officer that found them, all right, instead of somebody who just decided they want a kid, all right? You gotta keep an eye on her. It happens, and all of a sudden you come out and your kid's gone, then what do? There's no cameras here. We don't know where she went. You probably never see her again, you understand? It's a dangerous thing, okay? All right, get yourself home, calm yourself down, okay? It was a mistake, take care of it, and it's over, all right? Just don't do it again, you understand? I don't want to be looking for your kid everywhere, looking for somebody who kidnaps your kid, you understand?
Yeah.
You clearly care about your child. And I don't think you're a bad parent. I think you made this really stupid decision. Just don't make it again to get it taken care of, all right?
Yeah.
All right.
Kyla fue luego acusada de un cargo de poner en peligro a los niños. Fue declarada culpable en un tribunal de la alcaldía y se le cobró una multa de $330. Solo puedo esperar por el bien de su hija que Kyla tenga su vida resuelta y aprenda de esta experiencia. Y tristemente, las cosas empeoran a partir de ahora con el caso que sigue. Un caso tan increíblemente duro y brutal que no hay palabras para describir cómo algo como esto puede suceder, pero lo hizo. Revíselo siempre y asegúrese de que nada esté roto o demasiado atrás a mis ojos. Quiero decir, porque al mismo tiempo hay que entender esto. Tuve servicios sociales en mi casa tal vez 40 o 50 veces. Se trata de Al-Mutahan McLean, de 30 años, quien el 13 de diciembre de 2019 llamó al 911 y afirmó que su hijo de 10 años, Dakota Collins, no respiraba. A pesar de recibir instrucciones del operador sobre cómo realizar RCP, McLean no pudo hacer que Dakota volviera a respirar. Luego llegaron los paramédicos y transportaron a Dakota a un hospital local, donde luego fue declarado muerto. Pero eso no es todo. El examen inicial mostró que Dakota tenía varias cicatrices, lo que indicaba abuso. Al ver esto, McLean fue arrestado y llevado para ser interrogado. Lo que sigue hará de este uno de los casos más horribles y repugnantes de paternidad malvada que jamás haya visto.
Well, this is what happened. I ain't slept in about 3 days, right? The kid keep falling down the stairs, keep knocking his head around. It looked like something was wrong with his stomach last night that I noticed. And I gave him some water to throw up. You know what I mean? I had him drink like several cups of water because it looked very well. I just wanted to make sure that he was okay. So he drank the water and it was it. And I guess he goes back upstairs and acting out some more. I mean, jumping off the banister, everywhere, and everywhere, the usual, might I add. I've been dealing with this for probably like since he was 2 years old, he's been doing this.
El detective comienza preguntándole a McLean qué pasó ese día. Y sin perder un momento, McLean comienza a describir los comportamientos inusuales de Dakota que podrían explicar las cicatrices. McLean luego describe los horribles detalles que condujeron a la muerte de su hijo.
So, I'm very tired. I ain't slept in 3 days, so I'm just sitting there. And here he come rolling down the stairs again, ba-doom, ba-doom. So, I tell him go back upstairs. A little while later, I go up there, so I ask him, what is he doing? And he's just steady, you know what I mean? Just steady doing what he do. This ain't the first time he tried something like that. So, I see him on the ground, and I asked him to pull it out, you know what I mean? Heard immediately. Now I'm freaking out. I'm like, hurry up, I need to get downstairs so I can get you in the shower, you know what I mean? And see what's going on. So at the time, I didn't think nothing of it. I just see that he bruised up as usual. Seeing the old lady, he never stopped. They didn't find any way, any type of way, anything to use just to put a bruise on his body. So as a parent, I just put him in the shower. I mean, I put him in the bathtub to try to, you know, get some of the swelling to go down or whatever the situation may have been, you know, clean him up, make sure he was good. So I'm sitting on the couch. He's like, Dad, come here. He's like, Dad, help. So I come upstairs to help him. And that's when I noticed his body was cold, very, very, very cold. So I took him downstairs and tried to rinse him off, you know, to see if he had shaked out of it, wake up. I mean, I had no clue of knowing that he was sick to that extent or that, that this is gonna go anywhere near this far. I mean, I just figured he was doing his normal acting out. I mean, he was kind of tweaking a little bit, you know what I mean? But, yeah, as far as just, you know, like this, this is my way of describing it, you know, just like this. But this is something that he done pulled for many years. I mean, all the time, damn near every day, anytime he don't want to have his way, this is what he's pulling. Can't get him to eat his breakfast. He don't want to eat his breakfast. I'm like, all right, at this point, there's nothing I can do but let him sit there and lay down. Okay? So, like I said, he said, Dad, help. And I came up the stairs. That's why I'm shocked as right now. I'm not even in crying or nothing. I'm just like in shock. Like, my child really dead, have. You hear me? It's what I don't understand. Now, I know them girls ain't do nothing to him and kill him. I mean, I just don't understand it. I'm very serious. That's where I'm at. I'm in shock.
Pero si de alguna manera piensas que McLean es en realidad un buen padre y que todo esto fue un accidente, lo que estás a punto de ver demostrará que ese no es el caso en absoluto.
He had marks all over his body.
It's every day. Now, sometimes I had to sank his behind just to prevent him from hurting himself. This boy jumped out the window before. Out, just straight out the window. There is no stopping him. I'm afraid. I've been telling people I was afraid. But at the same time, it was nothing I can do. And I mean, I can understand the fact that he had marks all over his body. You'd be surprised just to sit there and watch him do it. Or just to see there, and you could just be like, stop, or no, or don't, and he's gonna whack, he's gonna bam, he's gonna jump, he's gonna flip, he's gonna kick. We had stairs he was letting up. He would kick him like that, you know what I mean? And kick him all kind of ways in the corner.
No, he lived upstairs.
At times, yeah.
What do you mean at times?
Well, at first he was living downstairs, but the smell got too strong. Not only that, my little brother, I just got custody of him probably like 2 years ago. I've been taking care of my little brother. Okay, so he been living with us. Do y'all have my little brother? Mm-hmm. Okay, good. I'm just making sure he's all right. Okay, so, yeah, my little brother started living with us, right? And Devop wanted to get aggressive with him and, you know what I mean? Try to take his clothes off in front of him and stuff like that. So, I mean, I had to protect him. I had to just send Dakota upstairs. I mean, the living environment, it was fine. It wasn't, it was perfect, actually. When he went up there, it didn't stink. He had a bed, he had clothes, he had everything he wanted. But this is the point that I'm trying to make as a parent. That's how far this shit go. Like, I can't get a boy a blanket. Because if I give him a blanket, now he has marks all over his body from him pissing on himself and wrapping around his own blanket. You know what I mean? If he did that continuously, there'd be rashes and, you know, that's unsanitary. Flat out. And there ain't no way to keep a child like that clean that just gonna do what they want to do no matter what, regardless. I mean, I done had social services out there. I called the police. The police told me he was being unruly and that when he got a little older, they'll be able to, you know, put him in some type of juvenile center. And I mean, this is the day after he jumped out the window. I mean, I'm traumatized every day. It's a new show. My child almost lost his foot. Here I am laying in the bed thinking he's asleep. You know what I mean? I mean, I'm laying in the bed thinking he's asleep. And I hear bam, bam, bam at the door. If you're upstairs, what are you doing outside? So not only did he jump through a window, but the window he jumped through was probably a little bigger than the square. A big fella like that, straight through it. I mean, he's impressive. So, like I said, he did that, and it just went on and on and on and on. Like I said, anytime that I put my hands on him, it was to keep him from hurting himself. And I mean, far as I wouldn't beat him with anything, I would just grab him and like, hey, enough's enough, like arms behind your back, like the police do, you know what I mean? It was never punch you in the eye or slam you or, you know what I mean? Never tried to do nothing out the way to him just to keep him from hurting himself. That was my biggest fear, and he just continued to hurt himself every day. He would have turned 11 3 days from now. And like I said, ma'am, I am shocked right now at this point that he died. Never seen it coming.
En este punto, McLean se había contradicho ya que acababa de pasar varios minutos explicando cómo el extraño comportamiento de Dakota pudo haberlo llevado a su muerte, solo para luego decir que nunca habría visto venir su muerte. Esto significa que McLean está mintiendo sobre el comportamiento de Dakota, o no se da cuenta hasta el punto de cometer negligencia criminal que resultó en la muerte de Dakota. McLean luego hace una declaración extraña, espontánea, que solo levanta las sospechas del detective.
To harass my child or do not like that, that's homophobic. And I mean that's homo, and I'm far from gay, you know what I mean?
Insinúa que no pudo haber abusado sexualmente de su hijo, no porque fuera su padre, sino porque ambos son hombres y McLean está lejos de ser gay. Solo demuestra el tipo de padre y persona que realmente es McLean. El detective, después de escuchar a McLean hablar sobre el comportamiento inusual de Dakota durante minutos, le pregunta si alguna vez habían llevado a Dakota al médico.
Yeah, he's been to the doctor.
He has?
Yeah.
What's the doctor?
It's been so long, I don't even know. I just know it was probably like when my health insurance ran out. Probably close to 3 years ago.
So the kid hasn't seen a doctor in 3 years?
Yeah, but he's been to the hospital and less than that.
When
so
was he at the hospital?
Probably like a year ago when he jumped out the window.
Eight children?
Yeah, he always been very healthy.
Okay. What? Who was his PCP? His primary caregiver.
I didn't have no primary
care physician.
No, I didn't have one.
Where did you take him to the doctor?
all he took him to the hospital, and all he took him to the doctor when he needed it, and he ain't, it won't, nothing wrong with it.
Decir que no le pasa nada cuando supuestamente está comiendo lo suyo es increíble, pero la cosa no termina aquí.
Yeah, in consideration. He's been in counseling his whole life. See, I can tell y'all.
So where did he go to therapy at?
He ain't been to therapy in a little while.
But he's on his own.
He has been, I'd say, probably like 4 years ago.
So he's been in counseling for 4 years, but he's been in his whole life.
Maybe off and on. I probably had some online counseling services or online counselors talk to him. But
where'd he go to school?
He's homeschooled. But the thing is, like when I did have counselors speak to him, he would play them so slick to the point where it'd be like, you know, he's all good and golden. Like they wouldn't believe the stories that I tell him. For me to tell somebody that he's getting anything like that, I mean he didn't have to do it. It's not something that we forced upon him or anything like that. Like if I would give him ice cream and a couple of cigarettes.
McLean declaró que Dakota, de 10 años de edad, que sufría de una enfermedad mental, que comía sus propias cosas corporales y forzaba objetos en su propio cuerpo, era lo suficientemente hábil como para interpretar a cada terapeuta que había visto. Es ridículo y absurdo. Se puede sospechar que McLean está tergiversando la verdad o mintiendo sobre cómo Dakota terminó con esas heridas. No solo eso, Dakota también cree que los cigarrillos son cosas normales que un niño querría y se pondría furioso.
If you gave him cigarettes, he would do stuff. Sorry, buddy, I'm trying to do this.
I'm saying if I would have given whatever he asks,
there we go.
He could be the perfect angel. You know what I mean? But let me say no, or you got suspended, so we can't do this. It ain't no punishing him.
He got suspended, so where's he going to school?
He was going to Horse Man. He's been homeschooled for the last 2 years.
Who's homeschooling him?
I was. Yeah.
Why do you have to think about that?
My lip hurt. I'm just like, You know, I've been up for 3 days. As I'm telling you, I still haven't took a nap, been to sleep. So I'm doing my best.
And you've been up for 3 days because he's been walking into walls and falling down.
Not 3 days straight, but every now and then. I mean, he would go maybe one day. Yeah, pretty much, or yelling. No, he's just yelling and screaming.
That's different than what you told us earlier, though.
No, that's what he do every day. But what I'm saying is what kept me up was his tone. Yelling, screaming, singing, dancing. Boy, it's 3 a.m. No sleep. Mm-mm.
Okay, so you homeschool him?
Yes.
What grade is he in?
5th grade.
Okay, and what's the stuff he's learning about right now?
Well, he was learning, but he refused to learn. Every book that I bought him, he on it, he it, he destroyed it. Pens became a factor of safety, and pencils, you know what I mean? I had legal documents stating that he was certified to be homeschooled.
Okay.
But like I said, he destroyed all his equipment, all of it. Sure. As a parent, I can't go out and just be like, I'm getting ready to replace all this.
So when was the last time he had schooling?
A true education, I could say probably like 2 years ago, before he got pulled out, Horseman.
Okay.
But he didn't learn anything. He wasn't doing that. He was threatening the teachers and telling them how he teach people a lesson and locking them out the classroom and, you know, just getting it in.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
He was locking the teachers out of the classroom?
Yep.
Okay. Earlier you called him a big fella. You think he was a big fella?
Do I? Yeah, a little bit. He kind of tall.
McLean, que había abandonado la escuela en octavo grado, había sacado a Dakota de la escuela en 3er grado para educarlo en casa, ya que su comportamiento se salía de control, como dejar a los maestros fuera de sus aulas. No hace falta ser un genio para ver que este hombre es todo menos una chispa brillante, y mucho menos un maestro. Luego, el detective comienza a establecer una cronología de los acontecimientos que tuvieron lugar el día de la muerte de Dakota. McLean comienza describiendo el día como otro día normal, en el que Dakota había insertado la pata de una silla. McLean supuestamente lo sacó, metió al niño en una ducha y lo volvió a acostar. Horas más tarde, Dakota pidió ayuda después de vomitar en la cama, tras lo cual McLean llevó al niño a la bañera para que lo limpiaran.
Okay. Not the shower, but I lay him in the bathtub.
Okay.
Like I said, he's still doing this. I'm mainly trying to get the throw up off of him again.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
All right, it's smelling awful, so I'm trying to get it off of him. And I realized that something ain't look right, so I call it 911. And I took him off the bathtub.
Mm-hmm.
And from there, I did everything that this vet said to try to save my child. He did start breathing again. He was looking at me for a second again. When the EMS got there, he told me to leave out. And I heard her say that he wasn't breathing again. And a couple minutes later, I heard her say he got his breath back. And then, and that was it.
So you got him out of the bath, and where did you put him?
I laid him on the living room floor behind the couch.
Okay, and you're doing what dispatch is telling you?
Yeah.
Okay. What happened? What did he do as he was laying there? You're giving him CPR.
What was he doing?
Mm-hmm.
He wasn't doing anything.
Was he breathing?
Barely.
Was anything coming out of his mouth?
Yep. Air.
Air?
Yep.
Okay.
He was breathing slowly.
Okay. Nothing else is coming out of his mouth?
Yeah. He started throwing up again.
Okay.
Yep. So what I did was I tried to lay him on the side to clear his passages away.
Okay. Where was he throwing up at? On the floor?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's in that blankets.
Okay.
And in that, by that jacket and the blankets where he packed that evidence up.
Okay.
Yeah, so
did you lay him on a blanket? He was just laying on the floor?
Yeah, yeah. I'm just freaking out at this point. I'm trying to get some clothes on him and get him right. You know what I mean?
And this is why you're on the phone with dispatch?
Yes.
You're trying to get him dressed?
Of course. Yeah.
So I mean,
so he can't go out the house but naked. It's wintertime.
Okay.
I mean, in my mind, I think I'm doing everything right. This doesn't happen every day.
Okay. So how did the throw-up get on the blanket and stuff?
How did the throw-up get on the blanket?
Yeah.
He might have been close enough to throw up on it. I don't know. Or it might have slid across the floor, maybe the blanket. You know what I mean?
You're the one that told me with all the blankets.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I'm walking back and forth, so maybe we scooped it on there somehow, or I'm not really sure how it got there, to be honest.
So how do you know it's there?
I kind of seen it a little bit. I'm not even 100% sure. Maybe I didn't. I told you it's been 3 days.
Okay.
Maybe I did, maybe I didn't.
Okay.
But one thing I do know, I believe I seen throw up on the edge of this white blanket. That's what I'm seeing in my head right now.
Aquí, el detective había presentado una prueba específica, la manta encontrada en el lugar con vómito. Lo hace para hacerle saber a McLean que ya han reunido todas las pruebas y quieren ver si su historia puede coincidir con las conclusiones que tenían en su contra. Dakota vivía con su padre, la novia de McLean, Amanda Hinze, la hermana de Amanda, Jennifer Ebert, y el hermano de 3 años de McLean. Así que era natural que el detective se preguntara cuál era la habitación de Dakota.
Well, look, it used to be in the back area, the biggest part.
Okay.
So we jumped off board. So we jumped out the window.
So you're talking about upstairs in the attic?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so where's his room at now?
It was still in the attic, but just the smaller portion.
Okay. Where is his bed at then, upstairs?
His bed?
Mm-hmm.
Every morning I put it in that back area. So he won't on it, maybe he'll have something clean to lay down in.
Okay, so you lock that area once you put his bed back there?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's where it was today then?
Yeah.
Back in that area locked?
Yeah, because look, that'd just be another thing for him to hurt himself on.
Okay.
The area ain't that big. He would just fly, I'm going to flip off the bed and crack my nugget. And then, you know, I'll be here regardless.
Okay. So you lock that back area?
Yes.
In the attic. So the attic's kind of like split up. You have the area where like the stairs are,
mm-hmm.
and then you have that like back room where there's like a blanket hanging from the door,
right.
and a door and a lock.
Right.
Right? Okay. And so every day you take his bed from the big area into the small area,
yeah.
and you throw it in there,
yeah.
and you lock the door.
Yeah.
Okay. So
it used to be all one. So you put that door and lock in there?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Because for safety, that's the measures. I had to board up. If you take a look, I boarded up all the windows in the room just to keep him from jumping out the window.
McLean afirma que mantuvieron a Dakota en el ático sin muebles para evitar que Dakota se hiciera daño. McLean había mantenido al niño encerrado las 24 horas del día, los 7 días de la semana, y también tenía una cámara vigilándolo en todo momento. Y dice todo esto casualmente cuando habla de su propio hijo.
The big area by the stairs?
Yeah. Okay. And, yeah, I heard him say, dad, straight up there.
And he pushed himself up off of his bed?
Yeah.
Okay, all right. And then you helped him down the stairs?
Mm-hmm.
And you put him in the bath?
Mm-hmm.
And you took him out of the bath?
Mm-hmm.
And, what'd you do with the water that was in the bathtub?
Left it in there.
You left it in there?
Yeah.
Did you leave a cigarette butt in there too?
Possibly.
Okay. And then so you laid him on the floor there in the living room behind the couch.
Mm-hmm.
And he's throwing up.
Mm-hmm.
What clothes did you put on him?
Tan pants, black t-shirt.
Okay. And where are the rest of his clothes?
He shit pissed them off, ripped them off. That's how bad it was. If I send him to school, they calling me saying he don't have a hood. His jacket is ripped in half. I got a price tag. I just went out and bought the jacket a day ago.
But he hasn't been to school in 2 years.
Right, but I'm talking about this is norm. So, I mean, he has other clothes. I mean, from his school year. Because he obviously didn't wear the same thing every day.
Okay.
So he had other clothes and other clothes and other clothes. But it got to the point where I just let him get his shorts and his t-shirt because he never went nowhere.
So when you went upstairs again, he was
naked? Yeah.
So he just sits upstairs naked all day?
Sometimes, yeah.
Why is that?
Because he pissed on himself and it just gave him a rash. Like, he is soaking down so good. I'm not exaggerating, man. Sometimes I go up there and I think I'm in the Pacific Ocean. How? I don't know. Can one get so much water? I mean, I monitor his water, too. I haven't given him more than he can bear or anything like that. You know what I mean? I try to give him enough to stay hydrated.
Es muy duro ver a un padre hablar como habla de su propio hijo y narrar una situación tan despreciable como esta. Pero si esto no fuera suficiente locura, McLean da otra explicación de por qué Dakota había estado insertando objetos en el interior.
I just want to go back to this too. You said this morning, first thing this morning, I think you said around 6 a.m. on the camera, you noticed he was clenching himself, I think was your word?
Yeah.
So he is...
But I wasn't quite sure because the light was off.
Okay, so like, there was like a yellow stool thing. Is that what you're talking about?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so
he must have snapped it off, because last time I checked, it was still connected inside of the thing.
I'm sorry, what?
It was still connected inside of the stool.
What do you mean?
The wooden piece?
Mm-hmm. The wooden piece was?
Still connected.
Who said anything about the wooden piece not being connected?
Who said anything about it not being connected?
You said that he must have snapped it off.
Yeah, he did. I had to.
When?
I noticed that this morning.
And that's what he was plunging?
Mm-hmm.
Can you describe what you mean by plunging to me?
All right, so look.
You're saying he's doing.
Yeah, but there's the thing. I wasn't able to tell if that's what he was doing or if he was just taking another shit. Because every night he'd get up and do stuff like this. You know what I mean? Now I'm like, what the f*** is going on? You know I gotta work. You only do it on the days that I gotta work the most.
Where do you work?
If ever I did work. Whenever I can, I try to go to the temp service led work, but I can't never work there that often because of the anxiety, the stress. I mean, I'm trying to hold it together. But
So this morning at 6 a.m. you see him, and I'm using your words, plunging on this chair.
Not quite sure. I seen close to it, and that's what it looked like to me. It just looked like social services. I mean, they like you can't stop him from being gay or you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. So you think he's doing this because he's gay?
I'm not sure if he wanted to hurt his. I know he liked to hurt himself every day. It's a combination.
McLean físicamente demuestra cómo Dakota USA partes de su cuerpo, así como otros objetos en sí mismo.
I haven't been asleep. So I gotta try to stay calm, you know what I mean,
mm-hmm.
as I can, and deal with the situation again, you know what I mean.
So how far in was it?
I can't say. That's the thing. I don't know.
You don't know?
Mm-mm, because I ripped it out so quick.
Okay.
Yeah, that's just kind of close. Not much. It was just like, just for a little bit. A little bit here, a little bit there. So I'm like, all right, let's have a look at it. You know what I mean? And all I see is it was swollen a little bit.
You didn't see any tears or cuts or...
Mm-mm.
No?
No.
Okay.
Mm-mm. Not at the time, no ma'am.
Okay. So you're taking off everything from the bath?
Yeah.
Okay. Is that the same bath water that was in there later, or did you change the bath water?
Same
bath water?
Yeah.
Okay. So...
Because I usually keep it the same, because, like I said, he's taking several baths a day.
So he's bleeding from his...
McLean luego dice que no cree haber matado a su hijo. También agrega que todas las mañanas retiraba la cama del ático y colocaba una lona para que Dakota pudiera recostarse sobre ella durante todo el día.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. We had TVs up there. Oh, it was a room. But he screwed up.
But that's not what it is today.
Uh-uh.
Today it's an empty room with a broken stool and a bucket.
Right, but it usually be his bedroom. Like I said, I open it up at night, I bring his bed out and bring his tarp out.
And by his bed, you mean like a green lawn chair?
I had to go with that route because you got to understand his parent. When you got to 11-year-old on that thing every day, what are you supposed to do, put a mattress?
I'm just making sure that that's the bed that you're talking about.
Yes, ma'am.
The green cot, lawn chair looking.
Yeah. And
so
the reason
did you put it in the other room then?
You said when?
Yeah.
This morning. Well, a little bit. Yeah, about mid-morning. Yeah. Probably after I went and checked on him the first time, yeah.
So you
no. Have- Yeah, second time after I went and checked on him. I'm like, we got to get this up. And I'm just looking over. He's responsive at the time. Like I said, he responsive. So I'm like, let me just get this out the way so we don't trip or get hurt. And I get him downstairs immediately.
Hasta ahora, la única evidencia que tienen los detectives sobre el comportamiento de Dakota es el testimonio de McLean. Entonces, cuando se le pregunta sobre cualquier evidencia física que pueda explicar el comportamiento del niño, McLean les dice a los detectives que solo ha hablado con un amigo suyo llamado John, pero que no parece tener un número de contacto ni el nombre completo de John, solo una dirección donde ambos se encuentran. La indiferencia de McLean ante las lesiones de su hijo también demuestra el hecho de que le importa muy poco, si es que le importa, la salud y el bienestar de Dakota.
Like I said, I've been up for 3 days. I barely made people be in that house around me like this. I don't pay attention to it much. Only concern I'd be worried about is if he about to crack his head open again. That's my only concern. Yeah, that is my only concern, I promise you, mama. And look, this is what I was trying to tell you. He did his leg like this on the stairs on that. Boom, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Both of them. Boom,
mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, I've been checking on him, right? This is over a course, 3-day period. And every day I'm checking his wounds, he got him packed with.
What, it packed with today?
Today, no.
No?
Not that I know of, no.
Okay. But they were packed with yesterday?
And the day before that. And the day before that. And the day before that.
I wonder why I didn't get to do that today.
We clean it every day.
Yeah.
Yeah, I wonder too. I don't know what happened. I'm still shocked. I'm telling you, I don't know. And it was like, he didn't make it. I'm like, wow. Are you serious? How? Like, what would kill him? I don't know.
So we're here to find out from you.
I don't think that, yeah, that's what I'm wondering. What would kill him? I don't.
Entonces estamos aquí para averiguarlo por ti? No lo creo, sí. Eso es lo que me pregunto. ¿Qué lo mataría? No sé. Después de esto, los detectives se toman un momento para reagruparse, posiblemente necesitándolo más que nunca después de las cosas viles que acaban de escuchar, y regresan para confrontar a McLean, comenzando con su historial criminal. Los cargos contra McLean incluían saltarse la libertad bajo fianza, alteración del orden público, poner en peligro a un niño, agresión, portar un arma oculta, delito grave de estrangulamiento y asfixia. McLean una vez había estrangulado a un hombre después de creer que le había robado el teléfono, solo para darle un puñetazo en la cara y robarle el teléfono.
I went to sleep a night at my baby mother house. Our kids was 3 and 4 years old. And one of them unlocked the door and went outside. And they was in their diapers playing in the front yard. And that's what it was about. My mom took the kids for a day or two and gave them right back to me.
Okay. There was one in here too for strangulation.
That was on a guy. That it was an even match. He attacked me. And I defended myself. I'm not a violent person. I just defended myself. And the guy actually came to court and told the truth and spoke on my behalf.
Después de tomar el ADN de McLean, los detectives luego lo confrontan porque sus historias no coinciden con los testimonios de otros. McLean luego cede y admite haber usado salsa picante como forma de castigo para el niño.
You know, we've talked to the other people here.
Okay.
And your story is not consistent with his injuries as theirs, okay? I will tell you that.
I don't know what to say.
Well, yeah. It's your chance. Like, I understand if you were frustrated with him at different points because you hadn't slept or because he would do things that bothered you or disgusted you. Oh, there's your chance to say it. But to blame him on him like he's doing it, yeah, we know that's
the only
case.
The only thing I probably did is spank his bottom or hold him down to keep him from eating. Everything else, I don't know nothing about.
Or put hot sauce, it'll burn.
That I did.
Yeah.
Yes, I did.
I know you did.
Yeah.
And why did you do that?
Just try to get him to quit cracking on himself. Yeah, my daddy did me like that when I was little. I used to suck my thumb, he put some hot sauce on, and I ain't put it in my mouth no more.
So you think putting hot sauce on would make him not?
Maybe it'd burn, because here's the thing, he would try to sit in it for so long to where it built up and just destroyed his skin. A bruise on a wet body that stays wet consistently all the time, I mean, it don't take much. Just to beat him randomly, nah, that never happened.
Ahora las cosas empiezan a parecer mucho más claras para todos nosotros. La marca de arrastre en el cuerpo de Dakota puede haber sido de McLean arrastrándolo fuera de la bañera. Pero McLean tiene otra historia que contar.
Like that drag mark, or that you call it.
Mm-hmm. That's what it looks like today.
Don't know what that is. I'm telling you, never seen it. Besides the fact, when I did see it, I just thought it was a rash.
So all these marks are probably spatula marks? Is that what you're telling me? I mean,
yes.
That's consistent.
Yes.
Yeah.
It is.
Okay.
Is that what killed him?
I would say the spatula marks did not. But possibly around or one of them or putting your or...
I did this morning, but it was only to keep him from hurting himself. Like, he didn't want to come off the thing that was in his, like, he wanted to fight for it. I'm like, I ripped it out, and he was still, you know what I mean, aggressive. I'm like, you need to lay down, settle down. He didn't want to lay down. I just tried to get him to calm down for a second.
So what did you do to make him calm down?
I just laid him down flat. And just, you know, put my knee on his back. I didn't put a lot of pressure on it. I just held it to where he could, you know what I mean?
Make him put his hands behind his back?
Yeah, because just anything to get him to stop. Because I couldn't watch it again. Him eat again.
So he's and you pulled this thing out of his it probably hurt. I mean, I'm guessing it hurt him.
It must have. I didn't know at the time. I mean, at all. I don't do I don't know nothing about it. What hurt was my pride and my feelings and the fact that he's up there doing that. He know how embarrassing that is. I'm like, what are you doing? Give me that. And that's when it squirted out, miss. And that's when I addressed it right away.
McLean ahora admite haber azotado a su hijo con una espátula y haberlo empujado al suelo con la rodilla en la espalda. Mientras explica cuán avergonzado y enojado lo hizo sentir el comportamiento de su hijo, McLean solo describe los eventos que conducirían a la muerte de Dakota.
I'm sure you were embarrassed and pissed.
Nah. Nobody was up. Nobody was there. Nobody was around that I knew of. You know? But usually, that's what I'm saying. Usually it can be, but no, I wasn't at the time.
So you pulled out of his and he's still fighting a little bit. You roll him over and you put your knee on his back, have him put his hands behind his back.
Yup, and I probably spanked him with a spatula a couple times, yes ma'am.
This morning too?
Yes ma'am. Yup, right when he put up the fight for the I did. Yeah, after I checked on his wound though, because it was my way of telling him, like, don't do that again. Do not.
So you put him in the bathtub, you check his right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and then you get him out and you whoop him?
Yeah, yes, ma'am.
Spatula.
Yeah, because I didn't want to whoop him right away, not knowing what was going on with his. You know what I mean?
And then you have him go back upstairs?
Yeah.
Did you put hot sauce on him today?
No. Mm-hmm.
So he goes back upstairs, and then at some point, you had thrown the bed into another room. Or was that later? I mean, I'm just trying to be accurate on this.
Yeah, that was, I'm trying to see what, asking again?
And then at some point he calls you up there again?
Yes, ma'am. Yup, and that's when I went to go check on him. And that's when it started not looking good.
He didn't look good?
Mm-mm.
So what did he look like then? He was laying on his bed?
Mm-hmm.
What did he look like?
And he pushed himself up and he was just like, Dad. He just, a little alert, a little loopy, you know what I mean? It was a little bit of both. And I decided to get him downstairs, try to wash that throw up out of him, and that's when he started to go away.
Okay. And you tied the water in from when he went down there earlier?
Mm-hmm. And he was in the water going like this and, you know what I mean, shaking and jumping, but I didn't have to hold him down or nothing in the water. Yeah, so he was laying on his side doing this, something he just putting on the show again, you know what I mean?
He puts on a show like he's having a seizure?
Yeah, 24/7. Like this.
Are you sure he's putting on a show? I mean, yes, he has been to the hospital.
Yes, ma'am. It was not a seizure because, look, I can tell him, like, stop it right now. Here's the sucker many times, and he would be like, okay, Dad. Thanks, my sucker. No, it was just a show.
McLean habla de cómo despidió a su hijo teniendo un ataque en la bañera cuando sabía que Dakota estaba dando un espectáculo. El pequeño giro que McLean había ingeniosamente añadido a la verdad sobre él ahogando a su propio hijo Dakota, se sabe que murió como resultado de este ahogamiento y el abuso físico que siguió. No solo eso, pregunta qué se hará con el cuerpo de Dakota, ya que teme que los médicos encuentren agua en sus pulmones. Cuando la policía dice que van a realizar una autopsia, les recuerda el agua que Dakota tuvo que beber y agregó que había oído agua en su cuerpo mientras intentaba reanimarlo.
Woke up lupus, so I'm thinking last night when I gave him all that water to drink, that get that out of his stomach, he could have had it in his lungs then and I didn't know it.
So you think he had a bunch of water in his
stomach? I did give him a whole bunch of, yes ma'am, I gave him a whole bunch of water because
today he drowned from it?
I'm thinking so, because look, I was trying to get the out of his stomach. I mean that. I swear to God, I do believe that's what happened. Because look, when I'm pumping my son's chest, I can feel the water. I can hear the water. You hear me? And his body. And on the phone, I didn't know. Yeah, he drank plenty of it. But at the time, like, I wasn't thinking that he could have died from it. You know what I mean? I only did it to help him.
Yeah.
Because he looked bad. His stomach was out the hair. I'm like, what in the hell did you been doing or what you been eating? Ain't nothing that good in this world to take you from this to that. And drink the water for me, please. He did. And,
Was it defiant about drinking the water?
He said, was he defiant? Not really. He was just slamming him down. Okay. And, he just slamming him down, slamming him down, slamming him down. And he did start to throw up.
So he threw up yesterday?
Last night, but not much. Mm-hmm. This is when I'm giving him the water to get him to throw up.
Okay.
He threw up a little bit. And I've seen it wasn't open. Or, and I try to get him to do it again. And, he didn't throw up.
McLean luego agrega que nunca puso sal en las heridas de Dakota, solo en el suelo. Es posible que esta historia haya sido inventada por él para justificar los resultados de la autopsia, que mostrarían literalmente sal en las heridas de Dakota. Para sorpresa de todos, McLean se atreve a decir que tiene miedo de lo que le pueda pasar, ya que siente que lo están culpando injustamente por la muerte de su hijo. Esto solo demuestra que, a diferencia de un padre normal, a McLean no le preocupa tanto la muerte de su hijo como sí mismo.
Got a question, if, I don't know, man. I'm afraid for my life. Yeah. I'm hurt that my child is gone. It's unbelievable. Like, I still don't believe right now. He's dead. Gone. Not coming back.
You're afraid for your life?
Yes, I am. Mm-hmm.
Your child's dead and you're afraid for your life?
I'll be spending the rest of my life in prison. I'm 30 years old. What I'm gonna do for the rest of my life, all because I tried to raise my child the right way and he became defiant and we ran into a situation. You know what I mean? People knew what he was doing. Yeah. But at the same time, it wasn't for them to do anything about it. It was for me to do something. I feel like I should have really just tried harder on getting them some better counsel.
Después de hacer un último intento poco entusiasta de ganarse la simpatía de los detectives, McLean es esposado y arrestado. Está acusado de asesinato y poner en peligro a un niño. McLean termina declarándose culpable del cargo, a pesar de protestar inicialmente. La autopsia de Dakota mostró abuso físico y sexual a largo plazo. A la luz de las pruebas obtenidas en su casa y de su propio testimonio, McLean es condenado a entre 51 años y cadena perpetua. Su novia, Amanda, es condenada a 22 años de prisión y la hermana de Amanda, Jennifer, es condenada a 8 años de prisión por permitir que continuaran los abusos a pesar de ser testigo de todo. A pesar de los antecedentes penales de McLean, las múltiples llamadas e informes y los consejos de los maestros, es sorprendente cómo CPS permitió que Dakota quedara al cuidado de McLean. Si CPS hubiera tomado medidas legítimas desde el principio, el abuso y la muerte de Dakota bien podrían haberse evitado. Pero la gente malvada que no debería tener hijos no se detiene aquí. El 19 de mayo de 2019, un ciudadano llamó a los agentes de policía de Cleveland a una residencia e informó haber escuchado gritos incesantes de los niños de la casa de al lado.
I don't hear anything.
Hi, did you call?
Yeah, I'm gonna call. Okay. She's there, they're screaming their heads off. She's got three kids. Sometimes she takes off and leaves them alone. They're babies. They're babies and pampers.
There's no, as far as you know, there's nobody up there.
No, I don't think there's nobody up there.
All right, because I know she's got a younger brother because I broke the ticket.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Well, they're screaming their heads off. Like, there's nobody up there. I mean, how you can leave three kids?
That's like normal screaming. Someone screaming
they're
out.
Screaming. You know, you figure
you
somebody would be up. I can hear from the bathroom upstairs.
All right, because I know I got a little one. When she cries, I'll let her sit there for 45 minutes until she
falls. Yeah, but this is constantly happening.
Whoa.
This is not normal.
I
can't hear anything.
Okay.
Como era de esperar, al no recibir respuesta, los oficiales regresan con la testigo y le piden que los lleve al lugar donde podían escuchar los gritos de los niños.
That's closed. That, but you can hear the kids. Actually, from there.
You said you heard them good from your bathroom?
Yeah, I can hear them, like, from here in this room. I can hear them, like, upstairs. I mean, I hope she's not up here drugged up or something. There's no way that's completely sealed.
Yeah, you have a boss who's not here. We're not getting no answer for them upstairs. I mean, we can hear the children crying about the downstairs room.
Yeah.
Can you hear it up
there? Yeah, clear as day, yeah. You can hear them.
Let's go. Let me see. So what does this door go to?
That door actually goes, it's like an entrance for their house.
But you know, it's like locked shut? There,
but it's closed because sealed. It's a second apartment. So that's
this
completely
won't open?
Sealed. No.
Hello, can you hear me? Hello? Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Hey, it's the police. Can you hear me? We're gonna kick in their door.
The door's completely locked back there?
Yeah, it's locked.
Usually she leaves it open.
I'll get my supervisor here and go from there, but we might end up kicking in that door. Kicking it in! Got it through on the right side. Little police! Little police!
Are you guys okay?
Huh? Can you talk to me, please? Are you guys okay? Where's your mom? Can you put some clothes on?
Una vez dentro, los agentes encuentran a tres niños de 2, 3 y 5 años encerrados en una habitación. No se pudo encontrar ningún adulto dentro de la casa. Sin embargo, momentos después, la madre, Liz Yomaris Torres Rivera, entra y se lleva una sorpresa impactante.
¡Oh! ¡Stop!
What's up?
¡Stop!
What's up?
Where have you been?
My
step out here.
Here.
Oops, sorry, bud. Sorry.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Why is this kid from alone?
My sister
hello?
Here.
No.
What
no sister.
Wait,
no
wait.
Sister.
No. Hello,
oh,
hello.
Hey, hey, come here.
You're gonna have to wait.
Hey,
ma'am.
Hey.
You're gonna wait out here.
Over here. Ah.
Wait.
I don't know who you are yet. No.
Let me see my kid.
Relax.
Wait.
Relax.
Oh my God,
relax.
No.
Where'd
she
come from?
What?
No, she just popped up out of the.
Stop.
I told you to stop. You weren't worried about your kids when you locked them in the bedroom and you took off, were you?
Let me see my kid.
Yeah, you got ID?
My here? My
where's
sister
your ID?
Is here.
Your
no, your sister's not here. No one's here.
Nobody's here.
Just the kids.
Three kids.
Where's your ID?
Where's your ID? Where is it?
Oh my God.
In your room? Listen, you're gonna push my buttons. Relax. You're gonna listen to me, and I'm gonna tell you what's gonna happen. Where's your ID? Okay, well.
They were locked in that room.
What's your name?
Okay.
You smell like you've been drinking. You just come from the bar. Where you at, Benny's?
Yeah.
Are these
yeah.
your kids?
Yeah.
Are these your kids? All right, you know what?
Yeah,
put your hands behind your back.
Wait.
Put
let
your
me,
hands.
Let me see my
no.
hands.
No. Your kids are fine.
Wait.
Stop.
Wait.
Take
wait,
it.
Stop
take it.
Right now.
Please.
Relax.
Stop it right now.
Relax.
Put your hands behind your back.
Please. Let me see my kids.
Your kids are fine. We're taking care
no,
of them.
No, let me
you
see.
You can't.
Let me see. Let me
do
see.
Not turn your
oh
face.
Oh, my
some
God.
What's up? Gotcha.
Let me see.
No, you're not
no.
seeing. Your kids are fine. We're taking care of them now. All right? You need to relax.
Oh, my God. No. Please.
No, stop.
Please.
Stop.
Daniel.
Tell him to get dressed.
Ma'am?
Tell him to put some clothes
no,
on.
I'll take
care
of
it.
All
right.
Just
we're
going
to take
her out
there.
Please.
Come on. Walk.
Please.
Go on.
Please.
Walk.
No.
Look. You walk or we're going to have to walk you. I'd rather you walk yourself. Come on.
Oh, my God.
Try to, once you get her info, see if there's a family
down
member.
Down oh, wait.
You know,
try that first
see,
night. Okay.
Do
come
I
on.
S-
come
s-
on. Walk.
Maybe
you gotta go outside. Come outside.
Walk. All you gotta do is listen right now. That's all you gotta do.
Here,
give me
my shoes.
Yours.
Where's your shoes?
My shoes.
Yeah.
I can.
Rivera había regresado a casa desde un bar y encontró a sus hijos siendo atendidos por la policía que había irrumpido. Después de ser esposada casi de inmediato, Rivera ruega ver a sus hijos, como si ahora hiciera una diferencia para demostrar que realmente le importaba. La policía notó que habían encontrado basura e insectos y que la residencia tenía un olor desagradable. No solo eso, los oficiales también afirmaron que, en el interior, se sentía entre 90 y 95 grados. Rivera fue expulsada por el propietario por dañar la propiedad y actualmente enfrenta cargos por poner en peligro a un menor. Tras su arresto, sus hijos quedaron al cuidado de un familiar. Todo niño merece un padre, pero no todo padre merece un hijo. Llegados aquí, ¿acaso no has visto este otro incidente? Yo no me lo perdería, ¿eh?